Okay, well, we'll get started. Welcome. It's lovely to see you all. We're going to wonder today in a bit of a different way, maybe a little bit different, not hugely different, though. Remember, our wonderings are unique to us and they're never wrong. And because it's our wonderings and not anybody else's wonderings. But first of all, I want us to just still ourselves a little bit and draw near to God and hear what he has to say to us tonight. I'm going to play a piece of music and it's called Gabriel's Oboe. It might be familiar to some of you, it might not be, it might be brand new to everyone, but I want us just to settle down and listen to this piece of music. I'm going to share my screen and we'll listen to it. A beautiful piece of music to begin our worship this morning, this evening even. our readings today are from Mark's Gospel. It's Mark chapter 6 and verses 1 to 13. I'm reading from the Contemporary English Version. Jesus left and returned to his hometown with his disciples. And the next Sabbath he taught in the Jewish meeting place. Many of the people who heard him were amazed and asked, how can he do this? Where did he get so much wisdom and the power to work these miracles? Isn't he the carpenter, the son of Mary? Aren't James, Joseph, Judas, and Simon his brothers? Don't his sisters live here in our town? The people are very unhappy because of what he was doing. But Jesus said, prophets are honoured by everyone except the people of their hometown and their relatives and their own family. Jesus could not work any miracles there except to heal a few sick people placing his hands in them. And he was surprised that the people did not have any faith. Jesus taught in all the neighbouring villages, and then he called together his 12 apostles and sent them out two by two with power over evil spirits. And he told them, you may take along a walking stick, but don't carry any food or travelling bag or any money. It's all right to wear sandals, but don't take along a change of clothes. And when you're welcomed into the home, stay there until you leave that town. And if any place won't welcome you, listen to your message, leave and shake the dust from your feet as a warning to them. And the apostles left and started telling everyone to turn to God. They forced out many demons and healed lots of sick people by putting olive oil on them. This week, we are going to explore being prepared to be vulnerable. This piece of music that I played, Gabriel's Oboe, it's a beautiful piece of music. And it's from that 1986 film called The Mission with Jeremy Irons and Robert De Niro. And its haunting melody is played over smooth strings, and it's just beautifully composed by Ennio Morricone. It's first heard at the beginning of the film, where Father Gabriel, a Jesuit priest, is a missionary, and he enters the jungle to preach to the Guarani tribe. And this tribe has a reputation of being quite violent to outsiders, and so he decides to go alone and play his oboe, hoping that the music will reach them and touch them. And he makes a difficult journey through the jungle to find the Guarani territory. And then he catches some sight of some of the tribe, and he begins to play. Slowly they creep closer and closer by the magical sound of the music. However, one of the tribe then becomes angry and grabs his oboe and snaps it. Another gestures to him to carry on playing, but he can't carry on playing because his oboe's damaged. So the tribesmen examine the oboe and beckon to him to follow them into the village where they repair it. And that begins a relationship with Father Gabriel and this tribe of people. It's the true start of mission. Gabriel is in need, and the Guarani can and do help him. But it takes a lot longer for them to trust him and accept him. And it's even longer still for them to even be open to the message. But it's where it all begins. That vulnerability and that putting yourself on the line is where it begins. Yeah. And it's very similar to the moment where the disciples enter a village. They've got nothing. They've been told not to take anything with them. So they've got nothing, but their people are hospitable. People welcome them into their homes. They're making themselves vulnerable and trusting that God's grace is with them by getting alongside people, getting to know them, because once you're trusted and accepted and respected, people maybe want to hear more about what you've got to say. We need to get back to basics. We need to develop relationships slowly so that trust can build and gradually grow to a point where people are able to really willingly hear the message that we've got to share, laying everything out in front of them, saying, this is what God has to hear, has to say. Are you willing to hear? Asking that it could make a real difference to our communities and to the people that we have relationship with, the people that we make contact with on our everyday lives. So I wonder what the most important part of this reading is for you. I wonder what the best part is. Wonder what is maybe the reading that you could miss out. And I wonder where you are in that story about the disciples being sent out. Or maybe it's the part where Jesus is rejected in his own hometown. So I wonder. Oh, you're all quiet tonight. Rosemary.
Thinking about the vulnerability bit, actually, because I think I take encouragement from Jesus, who made himself vulnerable, and the disciples made themselves vulnerable. That's a path of leadership which is very different from the world's point of view. And I'm just thinking that in vulnerability, you rely on God more because, your focus, I think, there is on God. And I'm just thinking when we had the Neath Talbot, the night shelter scheme, and I think we all came to that scheme feeling quite anxious and actually putting ourselves in a vulnerable situation, something that was an unknown thing for us. And by doing that, we were able to gain the trust of our guests and have those conversations, which were quite amazing. And we were blessed by that encounter. Mm-hmm. So it can feel an uncomfortable place to be. And yet out of that comes blessing.
Mm. Yeah. I do wonder whether it's easy to run away from being vulnerable when you're in that situation, and it's easy just to sort of say, oh no, maybe it's not a good idea to do this. Maybe we'll just back off a bit. So it's quite a brave thing to be vulnerable in that way.
I've always been a bit perturbed by the bit of that chapter, which says that when Jesus says, if you're not welcome, leave and shake the dust off your sandals. That happens to us all, surely, when what we're trying to do or say is rejected by people, but we try and try again. But Jesus seems to be saying, if you're not welcome, this is just leave, walk away. I don't quite understand that.
Maybe it's a bit about if it's not working, move on to the next thing. And we do that. We try things and it doesn't work, and so we don't do it again. We move on to something new, and maybe it's a bit about that.
But do you move on with other people, and are you still trying work with the people who so far rejected the idea,
Yes,
in other words, do you follow your belief that you're doing the right thing for God, or are you anchored back by people who don't want to go down that route?
That's right.
And that has happened in the past. In Skewin United Methodist, when they came together in 1909, it was only 10 years later that a faction within that church split off from the Methodism and started the Free Mission Church in Deneva Road.
Because
they didn't like the way things were going. Rightly or wrongly. So I don't think that's a bad thing. But we do try again to try and to persuade people that this is the right thing to do. It's a difficult one, isn't it?
I think it, part of it is like discerning when it is right to move on, isn't it? You know, it's just thinking about, you know, church and former circuit that kept on, you know, with a particular project and it just wasn't working. And then finally, they kind of realised actually it's all right not to work, you know, and they discovered a new project which was meeting a need and went from strength to strength. And that's, I think that's part of the vulnerability as well. It's recognising perhaps, you know, it's not quite right and we need to move on and leave that piece of work and move on. But the other thing that I sort of questioned about, and we're always kind of face rejection. You know, Jesus is kind of warning the disciples that that's what will happen, as he too was rejected in his own hometown. But there's also, I think, the thing about if we always stay in the place where it's comfortable, we never learn and grow. So this thing about kind of brushing the dust off your feet, I can see, you know, it's discerning when to kind of move on. But I'm just kind of wonder if sometimes actually we need to stay in the uncomfortable place, because if we don't, we're always going to be in a very comfortable place, stay where we are.
Yeah.
I totally agree, Rosemary. As I say, you're an example of night shelter. I must admit, I was anxious. I was fearful, really, of what I've left myself in for when I first started. I thought, gosh, what have I signed myself up for now? You know, and I felt really uncomfortable. And I had to push myself because I've committed myself, you know, to so many people to do this and do that. But I just asked the question, are we not just in our circuit, in Methodism, but generally in the country, are we who go to church too comfortable? It's more a meeting place for friends with faith, rather than stepping out and feeling uncomfortable about it and doing his work. And that is the nut we've got to crack. Yeah. Otherwise.
Yeah, I agree with that entirely. You know, and we are too comfortable, there's no doubt about that. You know, and we can't wait to get back to how things used to be, because we're comfortable with the way things were.
Yeah, because it's comfortable. But, yeah, exactly, yeah.
We've got to recognize there's going to be a new normal, and we've got to suss that out somehow.
Yeah, and I think it's, I mean, I suppose I'm in one of the unusual positions, Rosemary, being in the same position, whereas you've moved around a bit, and so you've not stayed in the one church, you've not stayed in your home church, and you've made yourself uncomfortable. When I first moved from my home in south side of Glasgow, which was quite poor, really. It was like Baglan. To my new people, obscuring. But anyway, it was mumbles maybe. So it was a bit posh. And I moved to the east end of Glasgow, to the 17th floor of a high-rise flat, and that was vulnerable. That was really vulnerable. I used to laugh because my mom said to me, when I moved in, she was in the lift. She said, "I don't understand anything these people are saying." And they were all from Glasgow. But, you know, I was called to go and do that vulnerable thing, to be in that uncomfortable place. And as a church, we were right in the center of this estate. So it was we were targets for lots of things. But the mission that happened in that place was amazing because of the relationships that we built up in the community. We worked hard at getting to know the shopkeepers, getting to know the school children, getting to know the families, being there, being at the heart of things. And I think as churches, we are maybe not good at that. We're not good at getting relationships with people who are within our community because we're too comfortable in our own skins. And maybe it's a bit like a pair of comfy slippers where they wear out eventually, and maybe we should then get some new ones and throw them away and get some new ones. And where are we at? Are we at the point where we're needing to throw them away and get new ones? I don't know. It's hard. And I also felt one of the bits of the passage that really resonates with me is Jesus being rejected in his hometown. Because I find it really difficult going back home to my home church because I get really critical of them. And I'm like, oh, you could be doing that so much better. and also, I lead worship in a different way from them. And my mum told me under no circumstances that I was ever to pray to God the Mother because... that was just not, it was not going to be acceptable. And at that point, and I still do occasionally, do pray to God in other forms and not just Father. So, it doesn't go down very well. They don't ask me to come and lead worship very often, in fact, ever. But that's okay. Maybe that's why. Because you have to move on. You have to move away. If you're called, you have to move away to unfamiliar places and be in that vulnerable state. I don't know.
I was thinking that, just leading up from what you're saying, Judy, I was thinking when I was invited to take the church anniversary for in a church where I grew up, you know, knee-high to a grasshopper, as my dad would say. So I've been going there since I was four, you know, because my parents took me there to Sunday school. And of course, a lot of the people in that congregation knew me as a small child. And now coming back as a middle-aged woman, a local preacher, as I was at that point before coming into ministry, they couldn't quite match the two. It was a bit like Jesus, you see. They couldn't quite see him. Is this the carpenter's son? Isn't he, you know? They couldn't get their mind around it because they saw him in one particular part of their lives, you know, of his life. And ministry, so for them he hadn't kind of sort of moved on. And it's a bit like I remember when I went away to college and then I came back to live in at home for a year, and my mother would say, mum would say, bless her, if you're going out, Rosemary, don't forget to lock the back door. And I was thinking, mum, you know, I'm 21 and I've been away from home, and I know that, you know, if I go out the back door, I've got to kind of, you know, it's that sort of scenario, really. And that required me to move on and recognise I'd moved on, and also for my mother to recognise I'd moved on as well. And it was, you know, that relationship was a different relationship then, you see.
Yeah.
When I was serving my apprenticeship, it was a four-year apprenticeship as a carpenter joiner. We were encouraged at the end of those 4 years to leave the company. Because they said, if you stay, you'll always be the apprentice. Mm-hmm. And even if you leave for 6 months and come back, you come back as a tradesman. Mm-hmm. And it is so true. It is so true.
Yeah.
Sorry, Ken.
Is that you, Ken?
You're on mute, Ken.
Are we that now? Okay now?
Yeah.
Rosemary mentioned Jesus, and I think that's the outstanding thing about this. Jesus moved on. he was brought up with the traditional Jews, and he said, a new commandment I bring you, something totally different. He was moving on, and he was getting away from the old traditions that had been practiced by the Jews still today. And that's why there's still a problem. So I think that Jesus moved on. And they instead of concentrating on the Jews, then they went out to the Gentiles. And that's when Paul took over.
But isn't that what the Wesleys done? They moved on, in a sense, yeah, from Anglican doctrine in those days. I just wonder, have we slipped back into traditional format? I don't know.
Again, it's what we're comfortable with, isn't it?
It's back to comfortable.
I think the coming of the pandemic has made us all vulnerable to a certain extent, because it's just totally something that we've never experienced before. And I can remember, you know, when it was announced that we're going into lockdown, and I getting bombarded with this bit of information, that bit of information, and I felt totally overwhelmed by it. And I was thinking, I just feel totally vulnerable here now, because I just do not know what to do here. And I've just got to trust God to see us through this, because it's just, you know, and I think, you know, we've kind of, for each one of us, that's been a different experience of that vulnerability, really.
And I suppose in lockdown as well, we took time. It took time to develop what we would know as worship, because we didn't do anything online until September. So we took the time. We developed it slowly. We built up the relationship, a bit like the story I told at the beginning. We took the time, and I think that's the slow building up of what you're trying to do. And you know, I think as Christians, we sometimes rush into things thinking, "Oh, we've got to do." We don't take the time to sit with God and hear what He's got to say, and then say, you know, just use us as it is.
I remember when back in last August, when we had part of the roof off St. Fields, and we were then talking about reopening the churches, if you remember, around about that time. And I went down to St. Fields to see what was going on after the phone call, and who should I see there but Judy. And Judy said, "God is telling us something. Keep it closed." And you know, some people said that the pandemic came, and God told us that we had to close, that we had to rethink our whole standing in the community. And if we don't do that, then we're going to fail. And I really believe that God has been telling us something. And we have to revisit what we do and how we do it. I firmly believe that.
Yeah. Okay,
I agree. I think a lot of the people are here now are on the same thought level, on a way forward generally. What worries me is the rest of our congregations, where are they in that thinking of where we're going to go, and how, if ever, are we going to bring those people up to speed? That was what concerns me.
Because
the majority want to go back to the same old, same old.
Yeah.
I do think it needs to take time, and we need to be patient with where God is taking us, and be vulnerable to where God is leading us. Because I think God is leading the churches somewhere. Yeah. Quite sure where He's leading us somewhere. let's pray together and kind of bring all those thoughts together. The greatness and the power of God are such a contrast to our weakness, yet our God loves us. The holiness and the goodness of God are such a contrast to our sinful nature, yet God loves us. We come and we offer our praise and our thanksgiving and give glory and honour to our God. Lord God, King of the universe, we thank you for sending your Son, our Saviour, as a helpless, vulnerable baby, dependent on the love and the care of flawed human beings. And as we make ourselves vulnerable, open to receiving more of your power, mercy, and love, so that we can share that with others when we are sent to serve you, make our lives a prayer to you as we lay our lives at your feet, as we draw close to your magical music in all our vulnerability. Let us lay all our concerns, all the things that we're worried about, all the people that we're worried about, all the pain and the suffering that we see around us, all the happiness and the joys, at the foot of your cross. This is where it begins, with our vulnerability and your words in our mouth. So we ask you to take our lives. Amen. We're going to listen to a version of Take My Life and Let It Be. It's very different. It's by Chris Tomlin, and the words are familiar, but the music will be different. So listen to it, enjoy it, ponder it. Maybe think where God is taking you in your life.
Filled with myself, and I will be ever only all for thee. Take myself, and I will be ever only all for thee. Here am I.
Let's share the grace together, because together we are all vulnerable and we're asked to step out and give our life to where God leads us. So let's share the grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, and the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with us all evermore.
Amen.